Welcome to the Band of Brothers. We meet each Friday morning at 6:30 at the First Baptist Church in Garden City. Our guests have spent some time this morning greeting each other and enjoying a hot breakfast. Now let's join Pastor Kenny Grant for today's Bible study.
Matthew chapter number 2. In Matthew, we have a part of the Christmas story, but it's important for us to understand what happens here in chapter number 2. I don't want to talk so much about the narrative. I want to just kind of like speak to you about a thought that comes out of this passage. But in Matthew chapter number 2, it gives us a little bit more of maybe the Christmas story. Now, I've said this before, you know, you've seen the nativity scenes. You've seen them all, and they will have the three principal people. Well, actually, there's only one principal person, that's Christ. But they'll have, in the nativity scene, you'll see Mary and Joseph and Jesus, and then the shepherds. Remember the shepherds from Luke chapter number 2. All of this happened that night. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior. And so the shepherds got there that night. So, and then beyond the shepherds, you'll see the angels, because angels spoke to the shepherds. And then beyond that, you'll see wise men, right? The narrative in Matthew 2 lets us know that this was a different time frame. But in the nativity scenes, we see that. We see Mary and Joseph and Jesus and the shepherds and the angels and the wise men. And then you see Santa Claus and Frosty the Snowman, and the Nutcracker, and the Little Drummer Boy, and it just keeps on going. Well, it is. It gets to be more difficult to untangle these things and understand what really happened. But this is happening as much as maybe a year and a half after Christ was born. This is Christ is called several times a child in this passage, a toddling child, not a babe. The shepherds got there and found the babe lying in a manger wrapped in the swaddling clothes. That was the sign that was given to them. So the shepherds saw one thing, and the wise men, the Bible doesn't tell us that there were three, they were magi. These were educated men who studied the sky, but they came from Babylon, Persia, whatever, but they came to see Christ. And they got there maybe a year and a half. I don't know how long it was, but I know that the king, when he would massacre the baby just to be safe, everybody two and under, all the boys, right? Because he was alarmed. Basically, this idea of a king was a threat to him, just like it's a threat to you. We don't think about it so much, but, you know, a monarch sits on the throne, and even your life, you remember? There's two things that's present in every life this morning, an altar and a throne, right? And whoever's on the throne determines who's on the altar. That's just the truth. And so when the king is on the throne, then I'll be on the altar, right? Usually we put Christ on the altar and we sit on the throne. But when the king comes, somebody's got to move out of the way, right? Because like you're in his seat. And so that's a threat to us. That's why a lot of people never want to come to Christ, because Christ demands that seat. And I tell you that because there is such a sinful, rebellious nature in us that we militate against God's rule in our life, his lordship. And we say Lord very, very easily. It rolls off our lips. But the truth of lordship requires me getting out of his seat. He sits there. And if he's on the throne, then I'll be where I'm supposed to be, which is on the altar. Right? But as I said, so it was a threat to the king. So we find out that this is a different story. But what I want to point out is something that maybe I've talked about 2 or 3 years ago and wanted to just kind of touch these bases again. And that is basically, how God reveals himself, how God speaks. It's interesting to know how God speaks. And so let's just read this passage here, and I want to bring some things out. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem, Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. Okay? Now, they came from, again, the Babylonian Empire, Persia, and they come around the Fertile Crescent to Jerusalem. Okay? And notice they come to Jerusalem saying, where is he that is born king of the Jews? Right? That's where you would come, because Jerusalem would be the place where the king would be. For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him. Then Herod the king, when Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, right? He was agitated. He was stirred, troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And this is the opposite of the Magi. The Magi had wonder, and the Magi came looking, right, westward, looking for this king. But Jerusalem was troubled. When he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for this it is written by the prophet, and thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the priests of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Right? Of course, you know that's a quote from Micah 5:2. Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of the Lord diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently for the young child. See that young child. And when ye have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also. When they had heard the king, they departed and said, lo, the star which they saw in the east. I'm sorry. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over the young child, where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshiped him. When they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. Now, in this story, we have God just revealing himself, and he's leading these men westward. And I just want to show you that God speaks, and it goes from a very, what I might call, what really is a general revelation down to a very specific revelation of himself. God is disclosing himself. God is showing himself. You know, God wants men to know where he is. Right? The Bible, there's a passage in Acts chapter number 17 that talks about the reason God set boundaries and all of these for man is that man might what? Grope after him. And that they might find him. But God is not trying to hide from man. No man. God wants men to know who he is and where he is. I've talking to our group on Tuesday, and one of the things that I was saying is that God's fundamental question to man is, where art thou? It's the first question God asked to Adam. Where art thou? After Adam had sinned, where art thou? Remember, when God asks a question, it's not for information. Right? God already knows. God's not asking for information. God is after confession. Well, we agree. We have to say to God where we are. And it's a thought-provoking question, because a man can't know where he is apart from God. The question is, where art thou? Not in relation to the bank, not in relation to your neighbor, right? In relationship to God. That's a fundamental question that every man has to ask. We have to be, and we are asked every morning, every day, every act, every deed, every thought, where am I in relationship to God? God is man's reference point. No sense in thinking you know yourself. This whole business of finding yourself. This is psychobabble. Right? You better know where God is and let God tell you where you are. Because you're going to come up with the wrong answers every time. That's called delusional, being delusional. Said before, if God says one thing and I say something else, God ain't wrong. So when God says I'm a sinner, I better own that. I better confess. I better say the same thing God says. If God says I'm forgiven, I better own that. And I don't walk around saying I'm guilty if God says I'm forgiven. So that thing works both ways. I mean, God is the one who tells me where I am. And I can't know where I am unless I know God. So the idea is I better know who God is, where God is, and then God will let me know where I am. God is the one who tells me. Okay? So God wants man to know who he is. God is revealing himself to him, to man. And we see it in this passage. The first revelation that God gives to these men was revelation in the, here it is, here's the word, the skies. All right? The skies. These men studied the sky. These were educated men, not necessarily astrologists, but astronomers. I'm not prepared, and I don't know whether I can do it, but even in astrology, these strange stories in astrology, if you follow even those things, it leads you to Christ. What I'm saying is there's a message in the sky. There's a revelation in the sky. There was a star that appeared to these men. God reveals himself in the sky. Now, if you read, and by the way, if you read Psalm 19, it follows the same kind of a pattern. Where it talks about basically, I think, these four ways God reveals himself. Okay? He reveals himself in the sky. The whole first part, I think the first six verses. In fact, let's go over there, Psalm 19, very quickly because we're out of time. But Psalm 19, and this is a great psalm from David. And he's basically showing us the same thing. First six verses here, where he talks about God's revelation of himself in the sky. The heavens declare the glory of the Lord. The glory of God, by the way, that word God is El. Right? The Almighty God. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the expanse of the firmament, space, showeth his handiwork. Right? So there's a revelation of God. There are some things to be known about God just by looking at the sky. Right? That's why the Bible says, I think, what is it, Psalm 14:1, that the fool has said in his heart, and Psalm 53:1, the fool has said in his heart, what, there is no God. You have to close your eyes to the reality of God. If the skies are right over our heads and they are screaming and they are preaching and proclaiming, day unto day uttereth speech and night unto night showeth knowledge. God is revealing himself. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. In other words, there's no language barrier. It doesn't matter what you speak. You look up and God is saying something. Their line or sentence is gone out through all the earth and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tabernacle for the sun, like a place to live. The sun comes out like a comes out of a lapel every morning and goes back into a tabernacle. Now, we know this is poetic language. The Psalms is poetry, and it's a song, it's prose. And so we talk about the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. We understand all of that, but it's poetic language. And the sun, man, comes up in the east like coming out of a tabernacle, and it runs its race across the sky. Right? All of these, 24 time zones? The sun is running its race, and it talks about that here, right? Which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber. That's talking about the glory of it. And rejoices as a strong man to run a race, talking about the power of it. Now, that's our sun. And David is speaking from our perspective, right? The sun is this major light in our solar system. It's our, I mean, we live by it. And by the way, people in David's day worship the sun. People in our day worship the sun. Okay? Many times you go to the beach rather than going to the church, you worship in the sun. Notice this. His going forth is from the end of the heavens, and the circus unto the end of it. And there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. In other words, everything on our planet is influenced by the sun. And so what he's saying is that, listen, the greatest light in our world is the sun. And he's using that. Now, our sun is at best a third-rate star. There are stars that make our sun look like a BB as compared to a beach ball as far as the brilliance and the size of it. Right? It's just a third-rate star in brightness and in power. But it's life to us, isn't it? So David is writing this. But God is revealing himself in the sky. Through our sun, through these heavenly bodies, God is showing himself. God is speaking. And that's what we see in Matthew chapter number 2. God speaking to these men in the sky. He puts this aster up there, this star, this light. What was it? I'm not prepared to talk about that, but it was a sign in the sky. God talks in the sky. But not only that. Now watch this, what it says, what they said in response, right? Saying, where is he that is born King of the Jews? Verse number 2, for we have seen his star, and it is his star in the east, and are come to worship him. Now, implicit in that tells you another way that God speaks. God speaks in the soul. You know why? Because worship is the response of the soul. And I'm telling you, all men are worshipers. God made men's knees to bend and to bow, and we're going to bow. Everybody's worshiping something. But God speaks to men in the soul. That's why men are without excuse. No escape, no excuse. Romans chapter number 1, Romans chapter number 2. Because God shows some things to man in the soul. Not just in the constellation, but in the conscience. See? God speaks to man this way. These men come to worship. Men look up over their head and they worship. Now, they may not want to know God by name. They may not. And by the way, you won't know God by name because this is a general revelation. But I'm going to tell you something. You can know his power and the fact that he's God. He can make that. His eternal power in Godhead. We can know that, Romans says, just by looking at the sky. It's a general revelation. But I want to tell you something. The very fact that a man bows his head in reverence, bends his knee, worships, is proof that there's a God. There is something greater than him. There is someone greater than him. And though I may not know his name, I may know very little, but the fact that I have been made to worship, and I'm going to worship, and everybody's going to worship, and everybody is worshiping. Worshiping your intellect or your money or yourself or your kids or grandkids, you or your career, Everybody's bowing down to something. Everybody. Because we're worshipers. And God made man to worship. See? So even over in Psalm 19, look over in Psalm 19 again. And he goes through from verse number 7 down to verse number 11. He's talking about something else. But look at verse number 12, where in this passage, the man, here's David, and notice what he says. Who can understand his errors? Now, here's just a man closed up to himself. But he's talking about errors. He's talking about secret faults. He's talking about keeping back thy servant from what? Presumptuous sins. You know what I call this? I call this the great knowing. Everybody has a great knowing. Conscience with knowledge. Conscience with knowledge. Everybody has this internal knowing. Our fallenness does not erase that. Now, we don't know who got it, but there's an inner knowing. Every man knows. Man who may not ever name the name of Jesus, he knows what shame is. He knows what error is. He knows what fault is. He knows what wrong is. People who may never name the name of Jesus, they wait to cover of night to perpetrate their sin, their crime. They don't want to be found out. And when they are found out, what do? Hang their head. A sense of shame, a sense of knowing, right? That's why when atheist says, I don't believe in God, I always say, I don't believe in atheists. Because every man knows, and you are fool to try to deny it. God doesn't try to define himself, defend himself. He just says you are fool if you say that he doesn't exist. Because you have to deny all of the evidence over your head and in your heart. Right? Now, man has a knowing. So this business of, you know, error, presumptuous sin, like, you know, and you know, you know, and you know, God knows, and you know, God knows, you know, he knows. That's true. And I've said this, don't argue with me. That's true. God has made man to worship. And so men who don't know who the true and living God is are worshiping. Worshiping stumps of trees. Worshiping nature. But they're worshiping. You know why? Because God speaks through the constellation of the skies. God speaks through the conscience of the soul. And then God speaks through the content of Scripture. God gives, notice in again in Psalm 19, he talks about this here in Psalm 19, verse number 7, down to verse number 11. Right? These wise men, they came because there was a star in the sky. These wise men came because they were driven by worship. Right? Something on the inside of them. Now watch this. They didn't know where they were going, so they came to Jerusalem. And what did they have to do when they were in Jerusalem? Ultimately, they had to go to the what? Scripture. The Scripture gave them a tighter focus of where God was, who God was, the Scripture. And in Psalm 19, it talks about the Scripture. In verse number 7, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The word of God will make you a wise person if you yield to it. Just by obeying it. You're wise for obeying it. And when you obey it, you've done wisely. It makes you wiser. Right? The statute of the Lord. And notice it talks about the law of the Lord and the testimony of the Lord, the statute of the Lord, all these different words. But it all has to do with scriptures. The statute of the Lord. All right. Rejoicing the heart. Really, when we fall in love with the word of God, it will rejoice our hearts. The truth will do that. Set us free. The commandment of the Lord is pure and light in the eyes. It'll cause you to see what other people can't see. The fear of the Lord, right, is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold. That's the most expensive or precious thing that they had in that day. Yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey in the honeycomb, the sweetest substance. He talked about the word of God. And let me just tell you, God speaks. Now watch, not just over our head, not just in our heart, but God gives us a clear revelation of himself in the word of God. Guys, this is why I say that you and I daily have to pull aside, get into the word of God. Because God will disclose himself to us in his word. How many of y'all believe that this is a living book? You said before, we read other books. We read other books, but this book reads us, doesn't it? I mean, I'm reading the Bible, I'm saying, God's got me again. It's like the light of the sun. No place where the heat of it is not felt. Listen, this Bible will pin your shoulders to the mat. And there ain't no getting around it. And there ain't nobody can escape it. It speaks to every man in every issue of life. There is nothing you will ever encounter in your life that fundamentally the Bible does not speak to. Every issue of life. That's why we need to learn how to handle it. Read it in, write it down, think it through, pray it over, store it up, live it out, pass it on. It's our life. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be thoroughly furnished under good work, absolutely equipped for living the way God. He's given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness in this book. And so watch. There is a revelation, a general revelation, that speaks to what God has encoded, what God has put it in me. And watch this. Now man is fallen, but the image of God in him is not erased. It's defaced. It's been vandalized. You follow me? But don't get the idea that man doesn't know. That's why God holds man responsible. That's why man is culpable. Because he does know. And God knows he knows. See? No excuse, no escape. Okay? But then God gives us his word. And that word searches us. You need to be in it. And I need to be in it. I need to study it. In 2019, I was given this idea. Maybe we can develop our own reading. How many of y'all read through the Bible in a year? How many of y'all have a reading plan? Well, maybe we can, as the Band of Brothers, read through the Bible in a year this year. We'll produce a reading schedule. Yeah. Now, listen, I'm not the popo. I ain't going to come by your house making sure you do it, all right? And I don't want you come by my house making sure. But we'll have this reading schedule where we can read through the Bible together. We know where we're reading, and we know where to hold each other accountable. But we need that, okay? We've been trusting that you're doing it, but we need to do that. So let's, in 2019, yeah, there's an app for that. There is an app for that, okay? Well, lastly, notice this. These wise men, they found out where Jesus was. And by the way, the people who told them that Jesus was to be born in Bethlehem. As far as I know, they didn't go to Bethlehem themselves, but they send the wise men there. That's absolute negligence on behalf of the Jews, right? Because he came to his own basically received him not. But these wise men went down. And when they got there, they searched diligently, right? And guess who they found? They found the Christ child. Right? And what have I said before, guys? You know this is true. This is God's full and final revelation of himself. Right? Very general revelation in the sky, but it speaks to God. Right? A sharper revelation of God in my soul, because that lets me know that the powerful God is also a moral God to whom I must answer. I bow my head. Ultimately, a man knows he bows before God. He's going to bow before God. Okay? He's made to bow. The scriptures tell us who God is. In fact, over in Psalm 19, it begins in verse number 7, it begins to use the word Lord. Up into that, it's been using the word God. But now in verse number 7, it begins to use the word Lord, which is what? Yahweh, Jehovah, God's covenant name. In other words, we can learn about God through that name. We can learn about God through the scripture. God makes promises. God keeps promises. God identifies himself to us. God extends himself to us. God discovers or discloses himself to us. Right? Remember what I said? You can't discover anything but what God has covered. And God shows himself in what he's covered. Now that sounds a little, you know, it's kind of like an Easter egg hunt. When you hide eggs for your kids, you hide them so they can find them. Don't you? Some of y'all said, that's a sin, Easter eggs. I'm not endorsing Easter egg, okay? But I'm just saying, when you hide things from your kids like Easter eggs, you hide them so they can find them. And man, God has put clues all over the place for man to grope after him and find him. He does it over our heads. He does it in our hearts. He does it in the scripture. And ultimately, it brings us to the person of Christ. Jesus said, he that has seen me has seen me. Well, imagine these wise men who come and they look at this young child. They are looking in the face of God incarnate. But now they've come to the right place because they've come to the right, what, person. And it's Jesus. And I'm just telling you guys, I'm closing. This is God's full revelation of himself. It's in Christ. Right? That's why the Bible says God has given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is what?
Lord.
To the what? Glory of God the Father. So I'm just say this, guys. It's wonderful that you come to a Bible study. It's wonderful that we have the Bible open and we're going verse by verse through the book of Exodus. But I want to show you this, that God is wanting you to see ultimately that there is a God. And if you want to know him, you have to know him through Jesus. Amen. Have you come to Christ? You can acknowledge, like everybody must acknowledge, there's a God. We look over our head. There's a God because there's a knowing. There's a God. His word searches us. It's true. There's a God, and here he is in full disclosure. He that has seen me has seen the Father. Have you bowed before Jesus? Have you worshiped him like the wise men? Have you been saved? Do you recognize him as your Savior, your Lord? Father, thank you for our opportunity today to enjoy fellowship. Thank you for the privilege of revelation. We recognize, dear God, that every revelation demands a proper response. So, Lord, for the man in this place who does not know Christ, Father, by your Spirit, cause him to see that he needs the Lord Jesus, in whom is life and life eternal. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. We're a band of brothers, just in perfect man, a broken host of sinners made whole again. Praise you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. We're a band of brothers, lead us in. We're a band of brothers, just in perfect men, a broken host of sinners, made whole again. We praise you for your mercy, thank you for your grace. We're a band of brothers, lead us in this place.